Welcome to On Repeat, the weekly podcast giving you an insight into the minds of musicians with me, Ellie Rashid.
And me, Hattie Winter. This week we are speaking to Benji Chief Appiah, a drummer, composer and teacher from Southeast London.
Benji. He uses his drumming to express his Ghanaian roots and the UK culture he grew up with. And I think that's something you can really hear in what he's probably best known for, which is being a part of the wonderful Steam Down.
And we do talk about Steam Down quite a lot in this episode. But Benji has also worked with a number of artists from the UK jazz scene, such as Nubya Garcia, Theon and Miss Maurice.
So if you're not familiar with Steam Down, it's basically an artist collective and a night that started off at a bar in Deptford called Buster Mantis before moving to another art space in Deptford called the Matchstick Piehouse, which is run by some of the coolest people in the world.
It's quickly grown into a community where hundreds, literally hundreds of people try to get in and watch the show each week.
Probably thousands if they could get in. And I was one of those many people queuing. But Steam Down have been called furiously energetic and known as the Jazz Renaissance.
It's got a super family type vibe.
Yep, the 8-piece band have a rotating number of guests and they've played at the likes of Glastonbury, Love Supreme, Brainchild, and not to mention Jazz Al Parque in Colombia.
Plus have gone on to win the Innovation Award and Live Experience of the Year Award featuring Kamasi Washington at the Jazz FM Awards in 2019.
In this episode, we'll be speaking to Benji about work ethic in the music industry and how important it is to just stay true to yourself as an artist.
I'll also note that this was the first episode we did all in the same room.
Oh, it was
one of the first episodes we did after all the lockdown stuff. So it was just great to catch up face to face and see Ellie as well. And hopefully you're liking this music in the background. This is from Steam Down's national anthem, Free My Skin.
Absolutely love this tune so much. Really can't stop dancing to it all the time. So sit back and keep it on repeat.
And actually, before you do, maybe just take 2 seconds if you're on Apple Podcasts to give us a review. It helps other people find us or rate us. It'd be really helpful. We do say that at the end, but just in case you need to know more.
That is a fab idea. You know something? This is actually also a great running track.
I was going to say, if Jesus did play an instrument, what instrument would it be?
Oh, God.
Gone. It wasn't the sitar.
So, that'd be interesting.
Probably. I reckon he could have played the sitar.
Okay, that's my vote.
Nice guess. Sitar?
What about you, Benji?
Nice guess. Love a sitar.
I'm going to say drums, honestly. I think he had like a little 1-2-2, like 2-step going for himself, like saying, like, this needs a beat, right.
Oh, yeah. Jesus is going to make a beat, yeah? well, they're like, not the meaning of life. And you're like, no.
This would be the pearly shuffle.
Yeah. Is it like a 1-2?
My thing is with drummers, we always have this thing. Yeah, piano players just look down like they're really in the mood. Drummers just look left. Every time, the hi-hats, they're like looking this way. Every time. I don't know why.
I've noticed this.
You see it?
You see it on TV,
Because I try and stand on the left-hand side. I gravitate towards the left-hand side because I know that's where the drummer's going to be looking. Yeah, and if I need a little cue, I'm like looking at him to my right. Like,
you better be looking up. Yeah, oh, man. It was just the one. Benjamin Appiah, also known as Benji. Also known as Benji on drums. Too many names. Or the Chief. Way too many names. I play drums with Steam Down. That's me. don't get me wrong, I love singing like in my head. That's not allowed ever. Because I realized like, I sound great when I'm with a band or when I'm with like a group of people, like yeah. 50 other people. Mm. Like, let's get that one guy with the mic, just singing the low notes. That was me. That was it. That's my job.
But have you ever sung in Steam Down?
I was forced one time. We had a gig in France.
Forced?
I'm saying forced because like I didn't want to. Yeah. Like, basically, one of us, one of our singers, Andrea, had hurt her foot. She had stepped on some glass, and she couldn't make it to with us to France. So we're at soundcheck, thinking like, oh, what are we gonna do? Like, we need someone who can sing. And all spontaneously, everybody just turns around, looks at me on drums, and like, oh, snap.
Did you not do the little left trick?
If I look left, I look at the bass player who's looking at me. If I look right, I'm looking at the keys player looking at me. It's like, okay, yeah, I'll sing. Put a mic next to me, see what happens, and then end up singing the singing for that one gig, which was a lot of fun. I do enjoy singing a little bit. But I don't think I'd ever do a solo. That was terrifying, huh? Singing. No, don't you dare. Don't even start, Ellie.
Oh, I was going to be like...
by yourself.
But what... Okay, so tell us what you play in Steam Down then.
Well, I play drums and percussion in Steam Down. That's basically what I do for a living, just hit things.
Nice.
They sound good.
You must, it's like anger management, musical anger management.
Basically was. When I started, it's like, yo, I'm so angry. Why are you angry? I have no idea, but it sounds nice.
I was like reading about you guys, like, yeah, and the Guardian. It's like, oh, you're at the forefront of like the London jazz scene. You're at the forefront of like the London nightlife scene. You're at the forefront of like so much. Do you ever find that quite terrifying?
Completely.
Yeah, that is a big like a title, a responsibility. Yeah. Like, yeah, do you feel like you have to live up to that a lot? And is it ever difficult to kind of be your like authentic selves and not, you know?
I feel like when it comes to being ourselves, like, we're completely calm. Like, we'll always be ourselves. Like, it's like, I can't really change the way I am because someone say like, oh, you're the face of jazz. I'm not the face of jazz. I do not want to be called the face of jazz. I want to be a person who makes jazz more fun for everybody to enjoy and makes music a thing that people can actually come in and actually be a part of. You don't have to be listening to it. You could be even playing it. You could be playing or listening to it, talking about it, start a podcast, talk about it here.
Hey, hey.
Literally. Or even just like, if you want to write a little review about it, like, yo, I went to this gig. It was all right. I went to this gig. Kind of shit. Like, everything you do related to music is like, we all want good things to come out of it. And like, so when someone comes to me saying like, oh, you're the face of jazz, it's like, you're doing so much stuff. I'm like, I am just blessed to be where I am. And I realize I just take every opportunity, because that's one thing that Miss Love and Mr. Watkins taught me right from the get-go. Take every single opportunity, and I did. She also told me never get a credit card, and I still haven't. Thank God.
It's good advice.
I'm not in debt. Well, kind of.
Steam Down, a lot of people know Steam Down, I think, from Piehouse in Deptford.
Yeah.
And because Hattie and I went to Goldsmith.
Oh.
So a lot
of our neck of the woods.
Yeah, exactly.
Our stomping ground.
So a lot of people we know are like, oh yeah, yeah. In fact, I know Rob, who does all the stuff. Shout out to Rob, who does all the stuff at the Pie House. I remember, because where I live is obviously miles away. And I remember, it's a trek. Honestly, it's a mission. It's actually like, it's like when you invited me to Hillyfield yesterday, I was like, this is a myth. I can't do it at all. But I remember going along, and I think I texted you, Benji, because I was like, I texted you like, all right, I'm coming. I'm with some mates. I'm gonna come in. Like, it's gonna be great. Made that journey. There was a queue outside that was like bigger than queues you see at Alton Towers.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm not talking fast track.
I
want to
get a fast track. Yeah.
I'm not talking fast track. Like, this queue, it was one in, one out. And it was like, we didn't get in.
Yeah.
I'm
sorry about that. I should have put you on the guest list for that one.
Honestly.
I didn't know you were coming to, like, you told me. I was like, oh, okay, cool. And then, like, I asked my manager, like, can we put her name on the list? No, that list is full time ago. Like, when was it full?
That's it.
Last week.
No, it's cool. I should have got myself organized, but I was actually, honestly, I was just happy. I was just really happy for you, because I didn't realize how popular it was going to be. And I think it was because there was an article in The Guardian.
Yeah, oh, yeah. There was, yeah. We had, I think it was at the time when we just did a thing with Kamasi Washington and he came down. And Shabaka Hutchinson came down too. That was a banger. Yeah, look, there's a lot of our friends came down and started playing with us. And then, like, The Guardian came down saying, like, yo, these people are amazing. It's all crazy cool. And it's like, after that, it just skyrocketed. And this was back when we were at Buster Mantis.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I love Buster Mantis. That room was sweaty.
Like, oh, yeah. Definitely.
It was like, don't get me wrong, I love that venue, but that was sweaty. Like, I had people's, like, sweat drops coming on my kit. I was like, yo, I don't want to play no more. I feel like it's just going to get into me. It was like, ugh. But the vibe and the energy was amazing over there. It was. And it was rammed.
Yeah. Mm. Remember doing one of my first jazz gigs there, actually.
Oh, is it?
Like, with my like contemporary, jazz band. That was,
I'm a big fan of Buster Mantis.
Yeah.
It's good. Yeah, really good food.
Should go back, actually.
I think, like, there's been obviously a lot of talk about, like, black-owned businesses, and I think that's, like, one of the only, like, clubs I can kind of think of.
Yeah, and, like, they've just opened
it's like the Stockton
Bar, yeah.
And another one as well.
Is it?
Yeah, Wilson Gordon, he owns, like, all three. Yeah,
I'm going to shout Gordon soon and saying, yo, if you need a, like, bartender or something, I don't know. If you need someone to do heavy lifting, I'm your guy.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And the Pie House does pie as well.
Yeah, oh my God, Pie House pies are dope.
Delish.
Yeah.
I'm not really a fan of pie, but I had one finally because everybody told me to. I was like, yo, ain't that bad, you know? Like, you're the gravy and stuff. Yo.
Oh, they're lovely people there. So I'm so glad that there was that kind of collaboration going on where you made them big and they made it was amazing.
It was honestly an amazing time for me, like, to work with them as well. Like, it was always like saying, oh, what can we do to make it better? Like, oh, let's change the sound system, let's get a new front desk, what can we do as a band, let's organize it so we can get everybody in and out. We talked to them about the one in, one out policy. Sorry, yeah. That, Ellie.
I forgive you now.
Because we knew that a lot of people were gonna come. And then the venue said, like, yo, we're going to have to, like, put a cap as 150 for legal purposes. And we're like, okay, that's fine. About 150 will come anyway. We didn't think any more will come in. And then, like, I remember, like, first time we moved to Pie House, we came there. Maybe 50 people came down. Because, like, people were wondering, like, oh, where is it? Has it moved from Boston Mantis? They didn't know where it was. And, like, the first week was, like, 50 people. Okay, cool. Second week, about over 300 people were coming through. And the line went out around the arches down the road, and I was like, these guys aren't getting in. Like, you do know that, right?
Someone should tell them.
Yeah, it's also funny when you have your friends in the line and say, yo, Benji, what's good? Haven't seen you in like 5 years. Can you get me on the guest list? Yo, you're my boy, but should have taken me earlier. Like, it's just how it is. Like, and I would love to get everybody in. I try my best to get everybody in at least once if I can, but if I can't do anything, and like, I'm going to say, the guys at Pie House are strict. Way stricter than me. I'm too nice. I'm way too like, oh, come on in, it's fine. Come on in, take my food. Come on in, take my drum kit.
Don't worry about health and safety.
Like, it's health and safety, man.
You're all small. You can squish.
Yeah, like the squish behind the drum kit make me feel uncomfortable.
Did you tell them I was small?
They can only tell. So
okay, this is something, like, when I'm showing people on Insta where they're like, oh, this is Steam Down, you know, they are so energetic, and everyone's, what is that dance called that everyone does at the festival? Because you,
we out here and Brainchild, both of those festivals, the song's called Grandpa.
Yeah.
And, it was just, oh, that song was so much fun to play, man. And, it was, yeah, literally put your hand on one hair, put your hand on your kidney, then walk side to side like, yo, this was the one. Like, literally thought it was like back at the African party. It was like, yo, where's the rice? Where's the chicken? It was like, yo, it's perfect. And it was such a good vibe. And like, I didn't expect everybody to like do that. Like, we're thinking like, you get a few guys who were like stubborn, like, I will never dance. And all of a sudden like, yo, I'm going low.
Yeah.
Like when you see that old person who can bend their knees lower than you, it's like, oh, snap. Yo.
Yeah, I know the feeling.
It's my-
I'm not very flexible, so I'm like, what?
I'm gonna be real. As soon as I joined Scene On, I end up being bare flexible, like saying, yo, I can like pop a bend down now, I can do this.
Yeah.
I can cut shapes, yo.
You should just I love how you have like that dance and then the next song could be like a mosh pit.
Oh yeah. And it has happened.
Yeah.
It has happened multiple times. Like, we out here was a mad funny thing.
When I was bringing my friends and we didn't get in, I mean, it was a nice evening, but I was trying to explain to them what genre Steam Down is.
Oh God.
Yeah, I was thinking this. Yeah.
What would you, I know that this is a difficult thing.
It's a mad question because like it has gone into so many different genres, like even being at the Wednesday nights, because you never know what's going to happen. Like all of a sudden it's like, yo, I like the Stiller vibe. Next thing you know, rock and roll, old school, and like then synth bass comes in, it's like, yo, techno, this is crazy. But I would say it's more Afrofuturism with lots of jazz influences, but also looks at grime, hip hop, popular music. Also, I would say a bit of classical music, because like we have people who come in and bring it on like little turns to it. Like the original keys player is Dominic Canning, who's an amazing keyboard player, and like he brings a crazy style to it on another level. But we also have a keys player called Lorenzo Kello Sengo, who comes in and plays as well. My best mate, much love to him. And he brings a really spontaneous kind of sound to it. Like, it's not, nothing's planned, but it's always just like sporadic, but also really chill at some points. Yeah. And it's like, yo, both of these keyboard players on another level, and like they all have their own like forms of genres they say it is. And it's like, it's always fun to hear how they bring it to Steam Down, and then ends up being a big old mess of fun.
That sounds amazing. I also think we should backtrack a little bit and explain what is Steam Down.
So Steam Down, I would say Steam Down is a collective / family of people. It's a community full of this amazing artists, musicians, spoken word artists, and also just people who come down there on a regular basis. Like, people who come to Steam Down are part of Steam Down. It's a big, one big family, one big happy family, I would say. And it's like, it was based on the fact of giving people a place to come and vibe and do things in, whether in music, and get away from their problems and get away from their like troubles and stuff like that. And it ended up being a way bigger thing than we thought it would be. Like, way bigger.
Yeah, that's
like
huge.
Literally, when I first, I was stepping in, originally when I first started, I was stepping in for Eddie Hicks, who's the drummer for Sons of Kemet. And Eddie was like, yo, do you want to come in and start doing this? And like, yeah, I'm definitely down for this. And then like I got there and I was scared out of my mind. He was like, yeah, just come in, come play. So it was myself and I'd say Theon Cross on tuba, and Dominic Canning on keys. Yeah. Mm. So we started playing together, and like the first few weeks was like a lot of fun. People started coming on their own volition, and people started coming on a regular basis. And when they did, it was just friends. Like, people say, yo, we're here to have a good time. Can we jump up? And they'll just jump up. We'll be cool with that. And like, it was just more about spreading ideas,
yeah,
and giving a place for people to actually do things. Like, Wayne was already thinking about like the future and like what he wanted to do with Steam Down.
So Wayne started.
Wayne started Steam Down officially. Yeah, that's his brainchild.
His brainchild.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, cool.
And he's been working on that a lot of recent as well. Like, we've done a lot with Steam Down of recent, and like recently we signed a record deal with Decca Universal.
Woo!
Appreciate that.
Hey,
it's the hype woman.
I appreciate that. Nah, it was definitely a surprise when I heard it, because like we were discussing it, and then like all of a sudden it's like, yeah, we're going with Universal. I'm like, eh? There's a deal from Universal? I was like, yeah. I'm like, as soon as I told my mom, she's like, ah, we're rich. I'm like, we? I was like, wait, mom, we? It's like, yes, we. I'm like, No. No. We. So you came from me.
So you were talking about how it's a kind of amazing mix and fusion of all different genres. Like, you've got different dancers going on. You've got a family, different people coming in and bringing their own influences. Mm-hmm. So does that have any kind of influence on the way that the music is written, and how is the music written? That's what, ooh, I want to know.
How is the music written?
How? Because it's so, it's an 8-piece, right?
Yeah.
It's an 8-piece. It is so complicated. Like, it is, it's intense. A lot of it really is intense. And how on earth does one get to write that kind of thing?
Honestly, it's, well, when it comes to writing music, it's more the vibe we bring. We literally just share ideas on the fly. It's like, yo, I've been working on this. I never really thought about it. What happens if I put this with this? It's like, oh, okay, that sounds nice. Yo, Ben, drop a groove. Oh, that sounds sick. Andrea, sing something over it. Woo, this sounds heavy. And all of a sudden, it's like, yo, we got a song. And it's always so much fun because everybody has their own style of music. Mm. Like, I was brought up on rock music and soul music. So, Stevie Wonder, Linkin Park. I was a weird child.
Yeah.
But, like...
That's great, though.
It was great for me, yeah. It was, like, I really enjoyed it.
Oh, wait, and yeah, who are you listening to?
Linkin Park, Boyz II Men, Mansell Brown, Yusuf Days. Yes. Alo Park.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm. Saba. A lot of Saba. The internet as well, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been banging out their music for a while, man. It's so good. Kamasi Washington and sort of his new stuff. Like, lovely guy. One of the nicest guys I've ever met. And Thundercat. Thundercat is a G.
Of course.
I met him on my birthday this year at Unit 31, and we just talked about anime the whole time.
Really?
Literally, he's like saying, there's another one of me. Yes. That's and he was so wearing cool. Cat ears and everything. It was dope.
Anyone else in your family musical?
No, I'm the first actual musician. Like, Papa actually took it seriously.
Wow. Did you have drum lessons? Like, because you were singing before, right?
So. Yeah, I was singing back in secondary school, and I sang in primary school a little bit. And I was classically trained by my teachers. I was in a choir, school chapel choir, and we went on tour a lot. But my drumming started in primary school when my school offered me drum lessons, like saying, like, yo, who wants drum lessons? We got a drum guy coming in. It's like, I was the only one to put my hand up. I was okay, cool. I have to get free drum lessons. And I did for like 3 months. And then the guy was like, yo, there's only one student, bun this, and then left.
Yeah.
And so, yeah. So primary school, year five and year six, I was just teaching myself. Just from videos.
How did you do that? Because I'm guessing...
I used to just go on AOL. I used to like pray to my mom, saying like, mom, please, can I go on the PC? Type my AOL password. I think I still remember my AOL password. What if it still works, actually? Oh,
I haven't thought about AOL, and you'd be like, please, can you not use the phone?
Yeah, oh my God,
and
my
parents are going to be like, get off the internet. And you're like,
yeah.
Oh, fully. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
My whole family, like, none of them are really musical. And then, like, when I got to secondary school, I couldn't afford drum lessons. So I was just there, standing outside the door of the drum room, just staring at all these guys near, like, Year 11 or year 10, just playing mad grooves. I'm like, I want to play like that. And they wouldn't let me in. the doors, so this is like a glass door, and it's me just staring at them, like, with my big old rucksack on my back, like, I'm ready to play. And like, they're not going to let me in.
Mm-mm. Like a year 7 when it's like the bags, it's like bigger than
the turtle bags.
Yeah. You want to like push them, and you're like, we're about to get back up.
I just started playing drums at school, and she started realizing, I'm actually really good at this. And then they put me in jazz band, and I was like, yeah, great. And I wasn't even the drummer for jazz band, I was the percussionist. So I'm on djembes and bells and stuff like that. And my friend Jesse was like playing some killer grooves. He was the best drummer in the school.
Mm.
And then I was like, I need to get better than him. So I practiced every day. I would come in before school, I'd get to school by 8 o'clock or 7:30 sometimes, and practice till 8:30. And then I go for roll call, form class. I'll go during lunchtime, break time, and then after school till 6 until they kick me out anyway.
Mm. Oh, wow. Dedication.
I did that 5 days a week. And then, it just got to the point where saying, like, oh, yeah, you're actually really good at music. And then they said, like, okay, we're going to keep going to do these tests with you and see how you go. And the tests were hard. I'm not going to lie. They were really pushing. Like, if you can do it, they will make you do it over and over again to get it right. And I really love that. I really appreciate that from them, because they really pushed me to the next level of being a musician. Mm. Also being a hard worker. Because of them, I was really able to like get to the mindset of like, practice does make perfect in the end. And like, you will get to where you want to go if you actually just push.
Mm. To be honest, Benji, I always saw you as a hard worker. Because when we met in Niger, National Youth Jazz, shout out. cut out the when I met you there with everyone else, I felt like we as singers, we took about 3 coffee breaks during the morning.
Oh,
we had a lot of breaks. And
coffee breaks and like the national youth, like I'm sure you were like teenage. You don't need coffee as teenagers.
Hot chocolate. We had the option, yeah. And yeah, remember, yeah, sometimes when we were really young, it was like, yes,
I'd love an espresso.
A mocha?
Yeah, espresso. yeah, I remember just coming back like when I think everyone had a break or whatever, and you'd always be playing.
Yeah, like everybody's on break. I'd be in the room just like shedding with Lorenz.
I remember. And I just used to be like, wow, like saying to the other singers, like, should stop drinking like I haven't taken so many breaks because these lot have it sorted out. And that's the thing with singers, because you don't really need to take any equipment with you, so we can sing and practice whilst we're getting our drinks. We're going out, imagine. But
I would like a baby chino, baby chino and a vodka, please. Do you rehearse much, spend much time rehearsing?
When we do, we go all out in the Steam Down. Like, I remember the first time we had like a big rehearsal, we did the Steam Down Orchestra, and we did that at the Jazz Cafe. So we had, basically we had written the music for an orchestra. So we had drums, tuba, bass, guitar, and maybe four or five horns. So we had like Nubya Garcia, Kasi Kanoshi, Sheila Maurice Gray, who else is on that? I think it was that. And then we had, yeah, Mark Mollison and Theon Cross adding into the Steam Down family. And we had like 2-3 days of rehearsals. It's like, I think from 11 to, yeah, 11 to about 10. Mm. And it's just like constant work and like saying, this has to sound nice. It has to be good. And like, at one point, I was one point where I was like, oh, okay, there was it. There's a song made by Kasi Kanoshi, where it's in 5/4, but it's for two drummers. So one drummer's playing in 4, one plus drummer's playing in 5, and then like the horn lines is so like, oh my god, so much fun to play. But it's like when I first learned it, it was so hard. I remember the first day after rehearsal, I was so let down by myself. I was like so angry at myself because I couldn't play it. So what I did was I went on YouTube and found like a 5/4 like metronome, and then I put it in my ear for the whole night. I was literally doing literally for the whole night. So the next day I'm literally in the taxi just going to the rehearsal space, and literally I'm just doing this on my lap. And I know the Uber driver is getting annoyed at me because he's just screwing me, like one of those death glares like through the glass. I'm like,
I don't want to know what your rating
is. Yeah. actually, my rating is like, what was it, 4.9? I'm cold.
Is that on?
He's actually a drummer.
On Bolt or like?
No, this is all on, still on Uber.
Captain.
Right. I was back on Bolt days. No, Uber days.
Right, okay.
Don't use it. Yeah. Okay. And yeah, I was like, because I was so disheartened by myself in the first day, I pushed and worked so hard that I basically didn't sleep the other night. Next day was like, I got there and I played it like, yo, I sound cold. And it's like, it was just like, you need to have that mentality. It's like, yo, if you have a short amount of time to get this work done before like a big show, you have to put time and effort in.
Mm.
And that was just my way of seeing it.
Yeah. You're very disciplined.
Yeah.
I think all the years of like going into school at like 7:30 and like not leaving till almost 12 hours later.
I blame my mum and my aunties, because I was raised by women in my family. So I was raised by my aunties, my mum, my sister, and they proper put discipline into me to work hard. Like, I'll go to my auntie's house and read a whole novel, but maybe like, yeah, just read a random novel and then write an essay about it every weekend with my auntie. My sister would be teaching me maths, literally every week, just going through my timetables. My mum would just be disciplining me if I did anything stupid, which I did a lot. I'm so sorry, mum.
It's funny because we did the podcast with Harrison and he kind of said a similar thing. And I feel like maybe it's only until the last 2 months that I realised is like, you can do anything you want, but you have to work hard at it. Whatever it is, you can do, anything is achievable, but you can't half-ass anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh yeah, there's no quick fix to anything.
Mm-hmm. Oh, fully, yeah. That's why when I told my parents, I told my mum and dad I was going to do jazz at university, they were like, well, we did say you have to do a degree, because that's the rule of my family. You need to have at least one degree. At least one. And it's like, okay, cool. I said I was going to do jazz. They were like, as long as you work hard and you get your degree, I won't say nothing about it. And she was cool with that. My uncle, on the other hand, didn't speak to me for a month. Best month of my life. I can't lie. Like, you have to like learn all the parts from the get-go. Like, especially like at Nigel, it was very like, everybody there was mad talented. And some of them came from very like higher class families where like they were like, they were gifted with lessons from the get-go, like from the day they were born. Me, no lessons at all. Lorenz had a few lessons back when he was in primary school and then basically learned like learned from himself, like me. And then we got there, we were like, okay, let's see what we can do. Let's vibe. We got there, didn't know jack. We were so confused. It was like, wait, there's charts? There's music? Yeah. We just improvised. It's like, and it was always funny because I remember like first day, it was like, oh, we're going to play, I'll take the A train. I was like, okay, cool. And I'm trying to play it, trying to hit all the hits in the charts. And like, Gem was like, that was good, Ben. It could be better, but it was good. I was like, oh, okay, thank you. Then this other young buck comes and plays the same song and kills it. I was like,
ah.
I wanted to like cuss him out, say, what the, like, proper, like,
but
like,
this is the real life whiplash. But
he's like, I'm trying to show me up, fam. It's like, nah, but he wasn't. He was just like doing his bits. Oh. And like, all credit to him, he was a sick drummer, still is a sick drummer, very gifted kid. And then because of that, me and Lorenz just looked at each other thinking like, yo, we gotta shed this. So we took the chart back home with us, and every day for a week, back at secondary school, we practiced our song lunchtime, break time, after school.
Brilliant.
That's that one song, Take the A Train, over and over again. Say like, where's the hits? On three. On three, da, da, da. Like, it was like, ah, oh, it was a banger. And then we got to the next week, and we're like saying, okay, we're playing Take the A Train. It's like, I'm playing this song. Put my hand up in the air like it's me. Me and Lorenz give each other a look like, we're going to do this. And we came there and smashed it. And let's say like, yo, that was amazing. Then they put a new chart on. It was like, oh, crap.
This is actually giving me some serious flashbacks.
Yeah,
right,
realizing new chart, new song. Let's get this.
No, seriously. Yeah, seriously. Because the thing is, basically, we went in a different room to...
Oh, yeah, you were downstairs. Yeah,
yeah, we were downstairs in the basement. And with our coffees and our baby chinos and our hot chocolates. And it was the same thing. So there was always somebody who would be singing with one of the bands. Mm. And they were kind of like the big deal. And then there was me who had a bit of a time management problem and still does. And I'd rock up. And I'd usually learn the chart as well. So, but you had to, honestly, everyone had to be so on it on learning the chart.
Mm-hmm.
You had to learn it so well. If you didn't know it, you were like out. It was like weakest link, honestly.
But that kind of like instilling a lot of professional discipline has set you like in good stead.
Yes, because like now I know it's like, yo, if you can't do the work, like just like you gotta work harder. Like for me, I've realized like from the get go, like this world is hard. Whether I'm doing music, whether like I do anything with business or ICT, anything like that, it's just gonna be mad difficult. So I need to put in effort every time. And like being at Nigel really taught me like, yo, I can be replaced.
But I found that sometimes having that mentality of I need to be better than this person, I need to be better than this person is great, but it kind of takes out and cancels the idea of collaboration within music, which is equally as important. And if you don't get that right, then it's not, it runs the risk of not being creative.
Like a different kind of movement throughout the industry.
Yeah,
so you have to collaborate.
That makes total sense. Like, I guess, like session.
Maybe I'm thinking of session. That's
like,
what I'm thinking.
Yeah, like depping and everything. But I know Benji, you teach, right?
Yeah, I teach at two schools, and one in West London, one in Central London. Yeah.
So, do you find that teaching has helped you at all in your practice?
Oh, definitely, by far. Because like, there'll be stuff I'm doing, like saying, "Yo, this move sounds sick," you know. And then a kid asks me, like, "How do you play it?" I'm like, oh snap. I just feel it, you know. I just like, I have that feeling. It's like, what's the feeling? I don't know, but it's good. And like, I don't know how to explain it. It's like, sometimes ideas come to your head like naturally, other times you have to really work for it and like feel it when you're playing it. And it's like being able to be a teacher and maybe proper explain it to a kid, like, oh, this is how you do it, this is how you can place it on a different groove, this is how you can play it and hit, make it hit so it's how it stands out in a song. But yeah, the idea of like teaching to younger people was so much fun for me, because it's like, yo, and get to look at how I play and how I can give it to someone else and see how they use it and how they play it. And if I can also learn from them, it's the best feeling ever. And like going back to your point about like having like that like working mentality, be better than everybody else. Like I want the kids I teach to work hard and realize, yo, they're good enough to be at that point, at the level of a next big superstar. Mm. Whether they're a drummer, vocalist, saxophonist, keys player, if you work hard and put the effort in, you could be the next person. But at the same time, you're not going to get there if you can't work with anybody. You need to actually be able to communicate and vibe with that person. Like, even if it's not even about music, just being friendly and talking and being open with a communication like that, whether it's music or not, having that vibe allows you to bring trust in the work environment. And like that will open up a whole new door to like music in general. Like, I've been doing music for a while now, just because I've been talking to bare people, because I've got a big mouth.
Trust me, that's why we have a podcast.
Yeah, that's so true.
Fair enough, yo. I've been able to ask so many questions about music business and where to take me and how do I like show myself to people and present myself and like how do I make myself unique to everybody else. And I've been talking to like drummers like Eddie Hicks, Yusuf Days, Femi Coley, also all guys who I love to death. These guys are amazing musicians and amazing human beings, like some of the best human beings I know. And they have their own style about how they play and what they wear and how they talk and how they are. And they're all real. Like, it's not even like they're trying to put on an act. Like, there's certain people who put on an act saying like, oh, I'm this guy, I'm meant to be the guy. It's like, you're not. Like, we know you're not. You're just acting. But these guys are real and they don't want to change, because that's the thing. When you try and change or be someone you're not, you end up putting yourself in a bubble where everybody thinks you're this person.
It's been so nice to speak to
a person in real life. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like all my social energy for the year has just come on to this like, this moment.
Like I said, and my mum has said, I have a big mouth. That's it.
No, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thanks so much for coming by.
Enjoying
doing this.
I was nice. Oh, that was dope, man.
Oh, Benji, thank you so much. It was so lovely to talk to you and spend a lovely evening together eating curry on my roof. If you want to keep up to date with what Benji's doing, you can follow him on Instagram. That's at Benji_on_drums. And you can also keep up to date with what Steamdown are doing. You can follow them on Instagram at Steamdown. That's just one word. And also, you must stream their track Free My Skin. It is so good. Check out their Spotify for more as well. Also, just like Hattie was saying at the beginning, if you want to leave a review, some feedback, a rating, follow us, subscribe, share the love, that would be so much appreciated, because then, you know, we can just share all this lovely music with everybody. Just spread the word, people, spread the word. And we will see you next week for probably a completely random artist. So keep it locked and keep it on repeat. See you soon.
We hope you've enjoyed the episode and want to keep us on repeat. You can follow, subscribe, and like us on your podcast platform of choice, and slide into our DMs on Instagram by following us at On Repeat the Podcast. All information will be included in the show notes.
On Repeat was made, produced, and edited by us, and the theme music is an original piece by Ellie's jazz band, Fujiyama, and wonderfully resampled by Dee, the producer, for the podcast. All of our guests give us permission to use their music. Thanks again for listening, and don't forget to keep it on repeat.